Now, fair Hapalda, our nuptial hour draws on apace. Four happy days bring in another moon. But oh, methinks how slow this old moon wanes. She lingers my desires.
4 days will quickly steep themselves in night. 4 nights will quickly dream away the time. And then the moon, like to a silver bow, new bent in heaven, shall behold the night of our solemnities.
Hippolyta, I woo thee with my sword, and one I love doing thee injuries. But I'll wed thee in another key, with pomp, with triumph, and with reveling.
Happy be Theseus, our renowned duke.
Thanks, good Aegeus. What's the news of thee?
Full of vexation come I with complaint against my child, my daughter Hermia. Stand forth, Demetrius. My noble lord, this man hath my consent to marry her. Stand forth, Lysander. And my gracious duke, this man hath bewitched the bosom of my child. With cunning hast thou filched my daughter's heart, turned her obedience, which is due to me, to stubborn harshness. And my gracious duke, be it so, she will not hear before your grace consent to marry with Demetrius. I beg the ancient privilege of Athens. As she is mine, I may dispose of her, which shall be either to this gentleman or to her death, according to our law, immediately provided in that case.
What say you, Hermia? Be advised, fair maid. To you, your father should be as a god. Demetrius is a worthy gentleman.
So is Lysander.
In himself he is, but in this kind, wanting your father's voice, the other must be held the worthier.
I would my father looked, but with my eyes.
Rather your eyes must with his judgment look.
I do entreat your grace to pardon me. I know not by what power I am made bold, but I beseech your grace that I may know the worst that may befall me in this case, if I refuse to wed Demetrius.
Either to die the death or to be abjured forever the society of men. Therefore, fair Hermia, question your desires. Know of your youth, examine well your blood, whether if you yield not to your father's choice, you could endure the livery of a nun.
So I will grow, so live, so die, my lord. I will my virgin pine up unto his lordship, whose unwished yoke my soul consents not to give sovereignty.
Take time to pause, and by the next moon, this healing day betwixt my love and me, for everlasting bond of fellowship. Upon that day, either prepare to die for disobedience to your father's will, or else to wed Demetrius as he would, or on Diana's altar to protest for austerity and single life.
Relent, sweet Hermia, and Lysander, yield thy crazed title to my certain right.
You have her father's love, Demetrius. Let me have Hermia's. Do you marry him?
Scornful Lysander, true he hath my love, and what is mine, my love shall render him, and she is mine, and all my right of her I do estate unto Demetrius.
I am, my lord, as well derived as he, as well possessed. My love is more than his. My fortune every way is fairly ranked, if not with vantage as Demetrius's. And which is more than all these boasts can be? I am beloved of beauteous Hermia. Why should not I then prosecute my right? Demetrius, I'll avouch it to his head, made love to Nestor's daughter Helena, and won her soul, and she, sweet lady, dotes, devoutly dotes in idolatry upon a spotted and inconstant man.
I must confess that I've heard so much, and with Demetrius thought to have spoke thereof, but being over full of self-affairs, my mind did lose it. But Demetrius, come, and come, Aegeus, you shall go with me. I have some private schooling for you both. For you, fair Hermia, look you armed to fit your fancies to your father's will, or else the law of Athens yields you up to death or to a vow of single life. Come, my Hippolyta. Which here, my love, Demetrius and Aegeus, go along.
With duty and desire, we follow you.
How now, my love? Why is your cheek so pale? How chance the roses there do fade so fast?
Belike for want of rain, which I could well be seen them from the tempest of my eyes.
Ay me, for aught that I could ever read. could ever hereby tell her history. The course of true love never did run smooth, but either it was different in blood.
A cross too high to be in was felled too low.
Or else it stood upon the choice of friends.
Oh, hell to choose love by another's eye.
Or if there was sympathy and choice, war, death, or sickness did lay siege to it.
Then let us teach our old trial patience, because it is a customary cross, as due to love, as thoughts and dreams and sighs, wishes and tears, poor fancy followers.
A good persuasion, therefore, hear me, Hermia. I have a widow aunt, a dowager of great revenue, and she hath no child. From Athens is her house, remote 7 leagues. There, gentle Hermia, may I marry thee, to the place the sharp Athenian law cannot pursue us. If thou lovest me, then steal forth thy father's house tomorrow night, and in the wood, a league without the town, where I did meet thee once with Helena, the two observance to mourn in May, there I will stay for thee.
Lysander, I swear to thee by Cupid's strongest bow, by his best arrow with the golden head, by all the vows that ever men have broke, in number more than ever woman spoke, in the same place thou hast appointed me, tomorrow truly I will meet with thee.
Keep promise, love. Look, here comes Helena.
Godspeed, fair Helena. Whither away?
You call me fair, that fair again unsay. Demetrius loves your fair, oh happy fair. Sickness is catching, oh, we're favor so. Yours would I catch, fair Hermia, ere I go. My ear should catch your voice, my eye, your eye. My tongue should catch your tongue's sweet melody. Were the world mine, Demetrius being baited, the rest I'd give to be to you translated. Oh, teach me how you look, and with what art you sway the motion of Demetrius's heart.
I frown upon him, yet he loves me still.
Oh, that your frowns would teach my smile such skill.
I give him curses, yet he gives me love.
Oh, that my prayers could such affection move.
The more I hate, the more he follows me.
The more I love, the more he hateth me.
His folly, Helena, is no fault of mine.
None but your beauty. Would that fault were mine.
Take comfort. He no more shall see my face. Lysander myself will fly this place.
Helen, to you our minds we will unfold. Tomorrow night, when Phoebe doth behold her silver visage in the watery glass, decking with liquid pearl the bladed grass, a time that lovers' flights doth still conceal, through Athens' gates have we devised a steal.
And in the woods, where often you and I upon faint primrose beds were wont to lie, and dang our bosoms with their counsel sweet, there my Lysander and myself shall meet, and thence from Athens turn away our eyes, seek new friends and stranger companies. Farewell, sweet playfellow, pray thou for us, and good luck grant thee by Demetrius. Keep word, Lysander, when we starve our sight from lover's food tomorrow deep midnight.
I will, my Hermia. Helena, adieu, as you on him Demetrius dote on you.
How happy some or other some can be. Through Athens I am thought as fair as she. But what of that? Demetrius thinks not so. He will not know all but he do know. And so as he errs, doting on Hermia's eyes, so I, admiring all of his qualities. Love looks not with the eyes, but with the mind. And therefore is winged Cupid painted blind. For ere Demetrius looked on Hermia's eyne, he hailed down oaths that he was only mine. And when this hail some heat from Hermia felt, so he dissolves, and the showers of oaths did melt. I will go tell him of fair Hermia's flight, and then to the wood tomorrow night pursue her, and for this intelligence, if I have thanks, it is a dear expense. But herein mean I to enrich my pain, to have his sight thither and back again.
Is all our company here?
You're best to call them generally man by man according to the script.
Here's a scroll of every man's name which is thought fit through all Athens to play in our interlude before the Duke and the Duchess on his wedding day and night.
First, good Peter Quince, say what the play treats on, then read the names of the actors, and so grow to a point.
Mary, our play is the most lamentable comedy and most cruel death of Pyramus and Thisbe.
A very good piece of work, I assure you. And a Mary now. Good Peter Quince, call forth your actors by the scrolls. Masters, spread yourselves.
Answers, I call you Nick Bottom, the weaver.
Ready, name what part I am and for proceed.
You, Nick Bottom, are sit down for Pyramus.
What is Pyramus, a lover or a tyrant?
A lover that kills himself, most gallant for love.
That will ask some tears in the true performing of it, if I do it. Let the audience look to their eyes. I'll move storms. I will condone some measures. To the rest, yet my chief humor is for a tyrant. I could play Urkel's rarely, or a part to tear a cat in. The raging rocks and shivering shocks shall break the locks of prison gates. Amphibious car shall shine from afar and make a mar the foolish fates. This was lofty. Now name the rest of the players. This is Urkel's vein, a tyrant's vein, a lover's more condoling.
Francis Flute, the bells mender.
Here, Peter Quince.
Flute, you must take Thisbe on you.
What is Thisbe, a wandering knight?
It is the lady that Pyramus must love.
Nay, faith, let me not play a woman. I have a beard coming.
That's all one. You shall play in the mask, and you may speak as small as you will.
And I may hide my face. Let me play Thisbe, too. I'll speak in a monstrous little voice. Thisbe, Thisbe, ah, Pyramus, lover dear, thy Thisbe dear and lady dear.
No, no, you must play Pyramus, and flute you Thisbe.
Well, proceed.
Tom Snout, the tinker.
Here, Peter Quince.
You must play Pyramus's father, myself, Thisbe's father, Snug the joiner, you the lion's part. I hope here's a play fitted.
Have you the lion's part written? Pray if it be, give it to me, for I'm slow of study.
You may do it extempore, for there's nothing but roaring.
Let me play the lion, too. I'll warrant that I'll do any man's good heart to hear me. I'll warrant that I'll make the duke say, let him roar again, let him roar again.
And you should do it too terribly. You would fright the duchess and the ladies that they would shriek, and that were enough to hang us all.
But I'll aggravate my voice so that I'll roar you as gently as any sucking dove. I'll roar you any tweer, any nightingale.
You can play no part but Pyramus, for Pyramus is a sweet-faced man, a proper man, as one shall see in a summer's day, a most lovely gentleman-like man. Therefore, you must needs play Pyramus. But, masters, hear your parts, and am I to entreat you, request you, and desire you, to con them by tomorrow and tomorrow night, and meet me in the palace wood, a mile without the town by moonlight. There we will rehearse, I pray you fail me not.
We will meet, and we may rehearse most obscenely and courageously. Take pains, be perfect, as you.
At the Duke's Oak we meet.
Enough, hold her bow cut strings. Exhume.
How now, spirit? Whither wander ye?
Over hill, over dale, through a bush, through a briar, over park, over pale, through a flood, through a fire. I do wander everywhere, sicker than the moon's sphere, and I serve the fairy queen to dew her orbs upon the green. I must go seek some dewdrops here, and hang a pearl in every cowslip's ear. Farewell, thou love of spirits, all be gone. Our queen and all our elves come here anon.
The king doth keep his revels here tonight. Take heed the queen not within his sight.
For Oberon is passing, fell in wrath, because that she as her attendant hath, a lovely boy stolen from an Indian king.
She never had so sweet a changeling.
And jealous Oberon would have the child, knight of his train, to trace the forest wild.
But she perforce withholds the loved boy, crowns him with flowers, and makes him all her joy. And now they never meet in grove or green.
By fountain clear, a spangled starlight sheen.
But they do square that all their elves for fear creep into an acorn cups and hide them there.
Either I mistake your shape in making quite, or else you are that shrewd and knavish sprite called Robin Goodfellow. Are you not he that frights the manes of the villagery?
Thou speakest aright. I am that merry wanderer of the night. I jest to Oberon and make him smile when I have fat and mean-fed horse beguile, neighing in likeness of a filly foal.
And sometimes lurk I in the gossip's bowl, in very likenessless of a roasted crab. When she drinks against her lips, I bob. And whether dewlap pour the ale, a merrier hour was never wasted there.
But room, fairy, here comes Oberon.
And here my mistress, would that he were gone.
Ill met by moonlight, proud Titania.
What, jealous Oberon? Fairy, skip hence, I have forsworn his bed and company.
Tarry, rash wanton, am I not thy lord?
Then I must be thy lady, but I know, when thou hast stolen away from fairyland, and in the shape of corn sat all day, playing on pipes of corn and versing love to amorous Phillida, why art thou here? Come from the farthest step of India, but that, forsooth, the bouncing Amazon, your buskin mistress and your warrior love, to Theseus must be wedded, and you come to give their bed joy and prosperity.
How canst thou thus for shame, Titania, glance at my credit with Hippolyta, knowing I know thy love for Theseus?
These are the forgeries of jealousy, and never, since the middle summer's spring, met we on hill, in dale, forest, or mead, by paved fountain, or by rushy brook, to dance our ringlets to the whistling wind. But with thy brawls, thou hast disturbed our sport. Therefore, the winds, piping to us in vain, as in revenge, have sucked up from the sea contagious fogs, which, falling in the land, have every pelting river made so proud, that they have overborne their continents. The ox hath therefore stretched his yoke in vain, the plowman lost his sweat, and the green corn hath rotted, ere his youth attained a beard. The human mortals want their winter cheer. No night is now with hymn or carol blessed. Therefore the moon, the governess of floods, pale in her anger, washes all the air that rheumatic diseases do abound. And thorough this distemperature, we see the seasons alter. The spring, the summer, the childing autumn, angry winter, change their wonted liveries. And the mazed world, by their increase, now knows not which is which. And this same progeny of evil comes from our debate, from our dissension. We are their parents and original.
Do you amend it then? It lies in you. Why should Titania cross her Oberon? I do but beg a little changeling boy to be my henchman.
Set your heart at rest. The fairyland buys not the child of me. His mother was a votress of my order, and in the spiced Indian air by night, full often hath she gossiped by my side, but she, being mortal, of that boy did die, and for her sake do I rear up her boy, and for her sake I will not part with him.
How long within this wood intend you stay?
Perchance till after Theseus' wedding day. If you will patiently dance in our round and see our moonlight revels, go with us. If not, shun me, and I will spare your haunts.
Give me that boy, and I will go with thee.
Not for thy fairy kingdom. Fairies, away. We shall chide downright if I longer stay.
Well, go thy way. Thou shalt not from this grove till I torment thee for this injury. My gentle Puck, come hither. Fetch me that flower. The herb I showed thee once, the juice of it on sleeping eyelids laid, will make or man or woman madly dote upon the next live creature that it sees.
I'll put a girdle round about the earth in 40 minutes.
Having once this juice, I'll watch Titania when she is asleep, and drop the liquor of it in her eyes. The next thing she then waking looks upon, be it on lion, bear, or wolf, or bull, on meddling monkey, or on busy ape, she shall pursue it with the soul of love. And ere I take this charm from off her sight, I'll make her render up her page to me. But who comes here? I am invisible, and I will overhear their conference.
I love thee not, pursue me not. Where's Lysander and fair Hermia? The one all slay, the other slay thee. Thou toldest me that they were stolen into this wood. And here I am, and would, within this wood, because I cannot meet my Hermia. Hence get thee gone and follow me no more.
You draw me, you hard-hearted adamant, but yet you draw not iron, for my heart is true as steel. Leave your power to draw, and I shall have no power to follow you.
Do I entice you? Do I speak you fair? Or do I, in plainest truth, tell you? I do not, nor cannot love you.
And even for that, I do love you more. I'm your spaniel, and Demetrius, the more you beat me, the more I will fawn on you. Use me but as your spaniel. Spurn me, strike me, neglect me, lose me, only give me leave, unworthy as I am, to follow you.
Tempt not too much at the hatred of my spirit, for I am sick when I do look on thee.
And I'm sick when I look not on you.
Do you impeach your modesty too much to leave the city and commit yourself? Into the hands that loves you not, to trust the opportunity of night, and the ill counsel of the desert place, the rich worthy of your virginity.
Your virtue is my privilege, for that is not night when I do see your face. Therefore, I think I am not in the night, nor doth this world lack worlds of company. For you, in my respect, are all the world.
Then how can it be said that I am alone when all the world is here to look on me?
I'll run from thee and hide me in the brakes and leave thee to the mercy of wildest beasts.
The wildest hath not such a heart as you.
I will not sty thy questions. Let me go. Thou follow me. Do not believe that I shall do thee mischief in the wood.
Ay, in the temple, in the town, in the field, you do me mischief. Fie, Demetrius, your wrongs do set a scandal in my sex. We cannot fight for love as men may do. We should be wooed, and we're not made to woo. I'll follow thee and make a heaven of hell to die upon the hand I love so well.
Fare thee well, nymph. Ere he do leave this grove, thou shalt fly him, and he shall seek thy love. Hast thou the flower there? Welcome, wanderer.
Aye, there it is.
I pray thee, give it me. I know a bank where the wild thyme blows, where oxlips and the nodding violet grows. There sleeps Titania some time of the night, lulled in these flowers with dances and delight. And there the snake throws her enameled skin, weed wide enough to wrap a fairy in. And with the juice of this I'll streak her eyes and make her full of hateful fantasies. Take thou some of it and seek through this grove. A sweet Athenian lady is in love with a disdainful youth. Anoint his eyes, but do it when the next thing he espies may be the lady. Thou shalt know the man by the Athenian garments he hath on. Affect it with some care that he may prove more fond on her than she upon her love. And look thou meet me ere the first cock crow.
Fear not, my lord. Your servant shall do so.
What thou seest when thou dost wake, do it for thy true love take, love and language for his sake. Be it ounce or cat or bear, pard or boar with bristled hair, in thy eye that shall appear, when thou wakest, it is thy dear. Wake when some vile thing is near.
Fair love, you fleet with wandering in the wood, and to speak troth, I have forgot our way. Well, rest us, Hermia, if you think it good, and tarry for the comfort of the day.
Be it so, Lysander, find you at a bed, for upon this bank will rest my head.
One turf shall serve as a pillow for us both, one heart, one bed, two bosoms, and one troth.
Nay, good Lysander, for my sake, my dear, lie further off yet, do not lie so near.
Oh, take the sense sweet of my innocence. Love takes the meaning in love's conference. I mean that my heart unto yours is knit, so that but one heart we can make of it, two bosoms interchained with an oath, so then two bosoms and a single troth. Then by your side no bedroom need deny, for lying so, Hermia, I do not lie.
Lysander riddles very prettily. Now much beshrew my manners and my pride, if Hermia meant to say Lysander lied. But, gentle friend, for love and courtesy, lie further off in human modesty. Such separation, as may well be said, becomes a virtue bachelor and a maid. So far be distant, and good night, sweet friend, thy love nor alter till thy sweet life end.
Amen, amen, to that fair prayer say I, and then end life when I am loyalty. Here's my bed. Sleep give thee all his rest.
With half thou wish, the wisher's eye be pressed.
Through the forest have I gone, but Athenian found I none, on whose eyes I might approve this flower's force and stirring love.
Knight in silence, who is here?
Weeds of Athens he doth wear.
This is he, my master said, despise the Athenian maid.
And hear the maidens sleeping sound on the dank and dirty ground. Pretty soul, she durst not lie, near this lack love, this kill courtesy.
Churl upon thy eyes I throw, all the power this charm doth owe. When thou wakest, let love forbid, sleep his seat on thy eyelid.
So awake when I am gone.
For I must now to Oberon.
Stay, though thou kill me, sweet Demetrius. Oh, I am out of breath in this fond chase. The more my prayer, the lesser is my grace. Happy is Hermia where sore she lies, for she hath an attractive eyes. How came her eyes so bright, not with salty tears? If so, my eyes are oftener washed than hers. No, I am as ugly as a bear, for beasts that meet me run away for fear. But who is here? Lysander on the ground, dead or asleep. I see no blood, no wound. Lysander, if you live, good sir, awake.
And run through fire I will for thy sweet sake. Transparent Helena, nature shows art, that through thy bosom makes me see thy heart. Where's Demetrius? Oh, how fit a word is that vile name to perish on my sword.
Do not say so, Lysander, say not so. What though he love your Hermia? Lord, what though? Yet Hermia still loves you. Then be content.
Content with Hermia? No, I do repent the tedious minutes I with her have spent. Not Hermia, but Helena I love. Who will not change a raven for a dove? The will of man is by his reason swayed, and reason says you are the worthier maid. And touching now the point of human skill, reason becomes martial to my will, and leads me to your eyes, where I overlook love's stories written in love's richest book.
Wherefore was I to this keen mockery born? Where at your hands did I deserve this scorn? Is it not enough? Is it not enough, young man? That I did never know nor never can deserve a sweet look from Demetrius's eyes. But you must flout my insufficiency. Good troth, you do me wrong, good sooth, you do, in such disdainful manner me to woo. Well, fare you well. Perforce, I must confess, I thought you, Lord, a more true gentleness. Oh, that a lady of one man refused should of another therefore be abused.
She sees not Hermia. Hermia, sleep thou there, and never mayest thou come Lysander near. For as a surfeit of the sweetest things, the deepest loathing to the stomach brings, of all be hated, but of the most of me, and all my powers, address your love and might to honor Helen and to be her knight.
Help me, Lysander, help me, do thy best to pluck this crawling serpent from my breast. Ay me, for pity, what a dream was here. Lysander, look how I do quake with fear. Methought a serpent eat my heart away, and you sat smiling at his cruel prey. Lysander, what removed? Lysander, Lord, what, out of hearing? Gone? No sound, no word? Alack, where are you? Speak, and if you hear, speak of all loves, I swoon almost with fear. Know that I will perceive you all not nigh, either death or you I'll find immediately.
Phenomena.
Are we all met?
Phenomena.
Pat, pat, and here's a marvelous convenient place for our rehearsal. This green plot shall be our stage. This hearth, burn break, our tiring house. And we will do it in action as we will do it before the duke.
Peter Quince.
What sayest thou, Bully Bottom?
There are things in this comedy of Pyramus and Thisbe that will never please. First, Pyramus must draw a sword to kill himself, which the ladies cannot abide. How answer you that?
Byron Lakin, a perilous fear?
I believe we must leave the killing out when all is done.
Not a whit. I have a device to make all well. Write me a prologue, and let the prologue seem to say, we will do no harm with our swords, and that Pyramus is not killed indeed. And for the more better assurance, tell them that I, Pyramus, am not Pyramus, but Bottom the Weaver. This will put them out of fear.
Well, we will have such a prologue. But there is two hard things. That is, to bring moonlight into a chamber. For, you know, Pyramus and Thisbe meet by moonlight.
Does the moon shine that night we play our play?
A calendar! A calendar! Look in the almanac. Find out moonshine. Find out moonshine.
Yes, it doth shine that night.
Why, then may you leave a casement of the great chamber window where we play open, and the moon may shine in at the casement.
Aye, or else one must come in with a bush of thorns and a lantern and say he comes to disfigure or to present the person moonshine. Then there is another thing. We must have a wall in the great chamber, for Pyramus and Thisbe did talk through the chink of a wall.
You never bring in a wall. What say you, Bottom?
Some man or other must present wall, and let him have some plaster, or some loam, or some rough cast about him, to signify wall, and let him hold his fingers thus. No. Hold on, give me a second. There we go. And through that cranny shall Pyramus and Thisbe whisper.
If that may be, then all is well. Come sit down, every mother's son, and rehearse your parts. Pyramus, you begin. When you've spoken your speech, enter into that break, and so everyone according to his cue.
What hempen homespuns have we swaggering here?
What? A play toward, I'll be an auditor, an actor too, perhaps if I see cause.
Speak, Pyramus. Thisbe, stand forth.
Thisbe, the flowers of odious savor sweet.
Odors, odors.
Odors, savor sweet. So hath thy breath, my dearest Thisbe dear. But hark, a voice. Stay thou but here a while, and by I will to thee appear.
A stranger, Pyramus, than ear play here.
Must I speak now?
I, Mary, must you, for you must understand, he goes but to see a noise that he heard, and is to come again.
Most radiant Pyramus, most lily white of hue, of color like the red rose on triumphant briar, as true as torch that yet would never tire, I'll meet thee, Pyramus, at Ninny's tomb.
Ninus, too, man, why must you must not speak that yet, that you answer to Pyramus. You speak all your part at once, cues and all. Pyramus, enter, your cue is past, it is. Never tire.
Oh, as true as Troas Taurus, they yet would never tire.
I were fair, Thisbe, I were only thine.
Oh, monstrous, oh, strange, we are haunted. Pray, masters, fly, masters, help.
I'll follow you, I'll lead you about around.
Through bog, through bush.
Through brake, through briar.
Sometimes a horse on me.
Sometimes a hound.
A hog.
A headless bear, sometimes a fire.
And neigh and bark and grunt and roar and barter.
Like horse, hound, hog, bear, fire at every turn.
Why do they run away? This is a knavery of them to make me afeard.
Oh, bottom. Thou art change. What do I see on thee?
What do you see? You see an asset of your own, do you?
Bless thee, bottom, bless thee. Thou art translated.
I see their knavery. This is to make an ass of me, to fright me, if they could. But I will not stir from this place. Do what they can. I will walk up and down here, and I will sing, and they shall hear I am not afraid. The ousel cock so black of hue, with orange tawny bill, the throstle with his note so true, the wren with little quill.
What angel wakes me from my flowery bed?
The finch, the sparrow, and the lark, the plain song cuckoo gray, whose note full many a man doth mark, and dares not answer nay.
I pray thee, gentle mortal, sing again. Mine ear is much enamored of thy note, so is mine eye enthralled to thy shape, and thy fair virtue's force, her force, doth move me on the first view to say, to swear I love thee.
Methinks, mistress, you should have little reason for that, and yet, to say the truth, reason and love keep little company together nowadays. Nay, I can gleek upon occasion.
Thou art as wise as thou art beautiful.
Not so, neither. But if I had wit enough to get out of this wood, I have enough to serve mine own turn.
Out of this wood do not desire to go. Thou shalt remain here, whether thou wilt or no. I am a spirit of no common rate. The summer still doth tend upon my state. And I do love thee, therefore go with me. I'll give thee fairies to attend on thee. Peas blossom, cobweb, moss, and mustard seed.
Ready.
And I.
And I.
And I.
Where shall we go?
Be
Be kind and courteous to this gentleman. Hop in his walks and gamble in his eyes. Feed him with apricocks and dewberries, with purple grapes, green figs, and mulberries. And pluck the wings from painted butterflies to fan the moonbeams from his sleeping eyes. Nod to him, elves, and do him courtesies.
Hail, mortal.
Hail.
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 Come, wait upon him. Lead him to my bower. The moon, methinks, looks with a watery eye. And when she weeps, weeps every little flower. Lamentings have enforced chastity.
Bang.
Tie up my love's tongue and bring him silently.
I wanted to tell you with then what it was that next came in her eye, what she must dote on in extremity. Here comes my messenger. How now, mad spirit? What I rule now about this haunted grove?
My mistress with a monster is in love, near to her close and consecrated bower, while she was in her dull and sleeping hour. The crew of patches, rude mechanicals, that work for bread upon Athenian stalls, were met together to rehearse a play intended for great Theseus's nuptial day.
The shallow thick skin of that barren sort, fear is presented in her sport, forsook his scene and entered in a break.
When I did him at disadvantage take.
An ass's null I fix on his head.
Anon his this be must be answered, and forth my mimic comes when they him spy. So at his sight away his fellows fly.
And at a step here all and o'er one falls. He murder cries and help from ass's calls.
I led them on in this distracted fear, left sweet Pyramus translated there.
When in that moment so came to pass, Titania awaked and straightway loved an ass.
This fault that better than I could divide. But hast thou yet rasped the Athenian's eyes? Beloved Zeus has ever thee do.
I took him sleeping. That is finished too.
And the Athenian woman by his side, that when he waked, of course, he must be eyed.
Stand close. This is the same Athenian.
This is the woman, but not this the man.
Oh, why rebuke you him that loves you so? Lay breath so bitter on your bitter foe.
Now I but tie, but I should use thee worse, for thou, I fear, hast given me cause to curse. If thou hast slain Lysander in his sleep, been o'er shoes or blood, plunge in the deep, and kill me too. The sun was not so true unto the day as he to me. Would he have stolen away from sleeping Hermia? It cannot be, but thou hast murdered him. So should a murderer look so dead, so grim.
So should the murderer look, and so should I, pierce through the heart with your stern cruelty. Yet you, the murderer, look as bright, as clear, as yonder Venus in her glimmering sphere.
What's this to my Lysander? Where is he? Ah, good Demetrius, wilt thou give him me?
I had rather give his carcass to my hounds.
Out, dog, out, cur, thou drivest me past the bounds of maiden's patience. Hast thou slain him, man? Henceforth, be never numbered among men.
You spend your passion on a misprized mood. I am not guilty of Lysander's blood, nor is he dead, for aught that I can tell.
I pray thee, tell me then that he is well.
And if I could, what should I get, therefore?
A privilege never to see me more, and from thy hated presence part I so, see me no more, whether he be dead or no.
There is no following her in this fierce vein. Here, therefore, for a while I will remain.
What hast thou done? Thou hast mistaken quite. And may the love juice of some true lover sight. About the west goes swifter than the wind, and Helen of Athens look thou find. By some illusion, seek thou bring her here, I'll charm his eyes against she do appear.
I go, look how I go, swifter than air from the Tartar's bow.
Bower of his purple dye, filled with cupid archery, thinking apple of his eye, once thou wakest, if she revive, beggar for her remedy.
Captain of our fairy band, Helena is here at hand.
And the youth mistook by me, pleading for a lover's fee.
Shall we their fond pageant see?
Lord, what fools these mortals be.
Stand aside, the noise they make will cause the beasts to awake.
Then will two at once woo one, that must needs be sport alone.
And those things do best please me that befall preposterously.
Why should you think that I should woo in scorn? Scorn and derision never come in tears. Look, when I vow, I weep, and vow so born, in their nativity all truth appears.
You do advance your cunning more and more. When truth kills truth, O devilish holy fray, these vows are Hermia's, will you give her o'er?
I had no judgment when to her I swore.
Nor in my mind, now give her o'er.
Demetrius loves her, and he loves not you.
O Helena, goddess nymph, perfect divine, to what my love shall I compare thine eyne? Crystal is muddy, O how ripened show, those pure congealed white Hyteris snow. When thou holdest of thy hand, O let me kiss this princess of white, this seal of bliss.
O spite, O hell, I see you were all bent to set against me for your merriment. If you were civil and knew courtesy, you would not do me this injury. If you were men, as men you are in show, you would not use a gentle lady so. To vow and swear and superpraise my parts, when I am sure you hate me with all your hearts. You both are rivals and love Hermia, and now both rivals to mock Helena.
You are unkind, Demetrius, be not so, for you love Hermia, this you know I know, and here with all goodwill with all my heart, in Hermia's love I yield you up my part, and yours of Helena to me bequeath, whom I do love and will do till my death.
Never did mockers waste more idle breath.
Lysander, keep thy Hermia, I will none. If ere loved her, all that love is gone. My heart to her but is guestwise adjourned, and now to Helen it is home returned, there to remain.
Helen, it is not so.
Disparage not the faith thou dost not know, lest, to thy peril, thou abide dear. Look where thy love comes, yonder it, thy dear.
Thou art not by mine eye, Lysander found mine ear. I think it brought me to thy sound, but why unkindly didst thou leave me so?
Why should he stay, whom love doth press to go?
What love could press Lysander from my side?
Lysander's love, that would not let him bide? Fair Helena, who more enjoins the night, all yon fiery oaths and eyes of light, while seekest thou me, cannot this make thee know? The hate I bear thee made me leave thee so?
You speak not as you think, it cannot be.
Lo, she is one of this confederacy. Now I perceive they have conjoined all three to fashion this false sport in spite of me. Injurious Hermia, most ungrateful maid, have you conspired? Have you with these contrived to bait me with this foul derision? Is all the counsel that we two have shared, the sisters' vows, the hours that we have spent, when we have child the hasty-footed time for parting us? Oh, it is all forgot, all school days, friendship, childhood, innocence. And will you rend our ancient love with Sander to join with men in scorning your poor friend? It is not friendly, 'tis not maidenly.
I'm amazed at your passionate words. I scorn you not, it seems you scorn me.
Have you not set Lysander as in scorn to follow me and praise my eyes and face and your other love, who even but now did spur me with his foot to call me goddess, nymph, divine, and rare, precious, celestial? Wherefore he speaks this, to her he hates, and wherefore doth Lysander deny your love so rich within his soul, but by your setting on, by your consent?
I understand not what you mean by this.
I do preserve or counterfeit sad looks, make mouths upon me when I turn my back, wink each at other, hold the sweet jest up. If you have any pity, grace, or manners, you would not make me such an argument. But fare ye well, 'tis partly my own fault, which death or absence soon shall remedy.
Stay gentle, Helena. Hear my excuse, my love, my life, my soul, fair Helena.
Oh, excellent!
Sweet, do not scorn her so.
She cannot entreat, I can compel.
Thy threats have no more strength than her weak prayers. Helen, I love thee, by my life I do. I swear by that which I will lose for thee, to prove him false that says I love thee not.
I say I love thee more than he can do.
If thou so, withdraw and prove it too.
Quick, come.
Lysander, where to tend all this?
Hang off, thou cat, thou burr, vile thing, let loose, or I will shake thee from me like a serpent.
Why are you grown so rude? What changes this sweet love?
Thy love, out tawny charter out, outlawed medicine, O hated potion hence.
Do you not jest?
Yes, sooth, and so do you.
Demetrius, I will keep my word with thee.
I would, I had your bond, for I perceive, a weak bond holds you. I'll not trust your word.
What should I hurt her? Strike her? Kill her dead? Although I hate her, I'll not harm her so.
What, can you do me greater harm than hate? Hate me, wherefore? Oh me, what news, my love? Am not I Hermia? Are not you Lysander? I'm spared now as I was erewhile. Since night you loved me, yes, since night you left me. Why, then you left me, oh, the gods forbid, in earnest shall I say.
Ay, by my life, and never did desire to see thee more. Therefore be out of hope, of question, of doubt. Be certain nothing truer. 'Tis no jest that I do hate thee and love Helena.
Oh, me! You juggler, you canker-blossom, you thief of love! What, have you come by night and stole my lover's heart from him?
Fine, I faith, have you no modesty, no maiden shame, no touch of bashfulness? What, will you tear impatient answers from my gentle tongue? Fie, fie, you counterfeit, you puppet, you!
Puppet? Why so? Ay, that way goes the game. Now I perceive that she hath made a pair between her statures. She hath urged her height, and with her personage, her tall personage, she hath prevailed with him. And are you grown so high in his esteem because I am so dwarfish and so low? How low am I, thou painted my coal? Speak, how low am I? Am I am not yet so low, but that my nails can reach unto thine eyes.
I pray you, though you mock me, gentlemen, let her not hurt me. For you perhaps may think, because she is something lower than myself, that I can match her?
Lower, hark again.
Hermia, do not be so bitter with me.
Be not afraid, she shall not harm thee, Helena.
No, sir, she shall not, though you take her part. Oh, when she's angry, she's keen and shrewd, and though she be but little, she's fierce.
Little again, nothing but low and little. Why will you suffer her to flout me thus? Let me come to her.
Get you gone, you dwarf, you minimus of hindering not grass made, you bead, you acorn.
You are too officious. In her behalf that scorns her services, let her alone. Speak not of Helena. Never so little show of love to her. Thou shalt abide it.
Now she holds me not. Now follow, if thou darest to try who's right, of thine or mine is most in Helena.
Follow? Nay, I'll go with thee, cheek by jowl.
You mistress, all this coil is long of you. Nay, go not back.
I will not trust you. I no longer stay in your cursed company. Your hands and mine are quicker for a fray. My legs are longer, though, to run away.
I'm amazed and know not what to say.
This is thy negligence, still thou mistakest, or else committest thy knavery as willfully.
Believe me, King of Shadows, I mistook. Did you not tell me I should know the man by the Athenian garment be had on? And so far blameless proves my enterprise that I have anointed an Athenian's eyes.
Thou seest these lovers seek a place to fight. Hie, therefore, Robin, overcast the night, and lead these testy rivals so astray, as one come not within another's way, till o'er their brows doth counterfeiting sleep, with leading legs and bending wings doth creep, then crush this herb into Lysander's eye, whose liquor hath this virtuous property, to take from thence all error with his might, and make his eyeballs roll with wonted sight. When they wake all this derision, shall see him a dream and fruitless vision. Was I in this affair do thee employ, all to my queen and beg her Indian boy, and then I will her charmed I release from monster's view, and all things shall be peace.
Up and down, I will lead them up and down. I am feared in field and town, goblin, lead them up and down.
Here comes one.
We'll be right back. On the ground, sleep sound, I'll apply to your eye, gentle lover remedy.
When thou wakest, thou takest true delight in the sight of thy former lady's eye.
And the country proverb known, that every man should take his own, in your waking shall be shown, Jack shall have Jill, naught shall go ill, the man shall have his mare again, and all shall be well.
Sit thee down upon this flowery bed, while I thy amiable cheeks do court, and stick musk roses in thy sleek smooth head, and kiss thy fair large ears with gentle dove. Sleep thou, and I will wind thee in my arms. Oh, how I love thee, how I dote on thee.
Welcome, good Robin. Seest thou this sweet sight? Her dotage now I do begin to pity, for meeting her of late behind the wood, seeking sweet favors from this hateful fool. I did upbraid her and fall out with her, and she amounts her begging my patience. I then did ask of her changeling child, but straight she gave me, and her fairy sent to bear him to my bower in Fairyland. And now I have the boy. I will undo this hateful imperfection of her eyes, and, gentle pug, take this transformed scalp from off the head of this Athenian swain, that he awaking when the other do, may all to Athens back again repair. I think no more of this night's accidents, but as the fierce vexation of the dream. But first, I release the fairy queen. Be as thou wast wont to be, see as thou wast wont to see. Now, my Titania, wake you, my sweet queen.
My Oberon, what visions have I seen? Methought I was enamored of an ass.
There lies your love.
How came these things to pass? Oh, how mine eyes do loathe his visage now.
Silence, while Robin, take off this head.
Now and thou wake it.
My own fool's eyes peep.
Now thou and I are new enmities, and will tomorrow, midnight solemnly, dance in Duke Theseus's house triumphantly, and blessed to all fair prosperity. There shall the pairs of faithful lovers be wedded with Theseus all in joy.
We will, fair queen, up to the mountain's top, and mark the musical confusion of hounds and echo in conjunction.
I was with Hercules and Cadmus once, when in a wood of Crete they bayed the bear with hounds of Sparta, never did I hear such gallant chiding. The skies, the fountains, every region near, seemed all one mutual cry. I never heard so musical a discord, such sweet thunder.
My hounds are bred out of the Spartan kind, so fluid, so sanded, and a cry more tunable. Was never hollowed to nor cheered with horn, in Crete and Sparta nor in Thessaly. Judge when here, but soft, what necessities?
My lord, this is my daughter here asleep, and this Lysander, this Demetrius is, this Helena, old Nader's Helena, I wonder if they're being here together.
No doubt they rose up early to observe the rite of May, and hearing our intent, came here and grace our solemnity. But speak, Aegeus, is not this the day that Hermia should give answer of her choice?
It is, my lord.
Good morrow, friend. St. Valentine is past. Begin these woodbirds but to couple now?
Pardon, my lord.
I pray you all, stand up. I know you two are rival enemies. How come this gentle concord in the world that hatred is so far from jealousy, to sleep by hate and fear no enmity?
My lord, I shall reply amazedly, half asleep, half waking, but as yet I swear I cannot truly say how I came here. But as I think, for truly what I speak, and now do I bethink me so it is. I came with Hermia hither. Our intent was to be gone from Athens, or we might, without the peril of the Athenian law.
Enough, enough, my lord, you have enough. I beg the law upon his head. They would have stolen away, they would, Demetrius, thereby to have defeated you and me, you of your wife, and me of my consent, that she should be your wife.
My lord, fair Helen told me of their stealth, of this their purpose hither to this wood, and I, in fury, hither followed them, fair Helena, in fancy, following me. But my good lord, I would not by what power, but by some power it is, my love to Hermia, melted as the snow, in all the faith, the virtue of my heart,
The object and the pleasure of mine eye is only Helena. To her, my lord, I was betrothed ere I saw Hermia. But like in sickness did I loathe this food, but as in health come to my natural taste. Now I do wish it, love it, long for it, and will evermore be true to it.
Dear lovers, you are fortunately met. Of this discourse we will hear anon. Aegis, I will overbear your will, for in this temple by and by with us. These couples shall eternally be knit. And for the morning now is something warm. Our purposed hunting shall be set aside. Away with us to Athens, three and three. We'll hold a feast in great solemnity. Come, Hippolyta.
These things seem small and undistinguishable.
Methinks I see things with a parted eye when everything seems doubtful.
So methinks, and I have found Demetrius like a jewel, mine own and not mine own.
Are you sure that we are awake? It seems to me that we sleep, we dream. Do you not think the Duke was here and bid us follow him?
Yes, and my father.
And Hippolyta.
We did bid us follow to the temple?
Why then, we are awake. Let's follow him, and by the way, let us recount our dreams.
When my cue comes, call me, and I will answer. My next is, most fair Pyramus. Hi-ho, Peter Quince, flute, the bellows mender, snout, the tinker, starveling, God's my life stolen hence, and left me asleep. I've had a most rare vision. I've had a dream past the wit of man to say what dream it was. Man is but an ass if he go about to expound this dream. Methought I was, there is no man can tell what. Methought I was, methought I had. But man is but a patched fool if he will offer to say what methought I had. I will get Peter Quince to write a ballad of this dream. It shall be called Bottom's Dream, because it hath no bottom, and I will sing it in the latter end of a play before the Duke.
Have you sent to Bottom's house? Is he come home yet?
He cannot be heard of out of the that he transported.
If he come not, then the play is marred. It goes not forward, doth it?
It is not possible. You have not man all Athens able to discharge Pyramus, but he...
No, he hath simply the best wit of any handicraft man in Athens.
Yeah, and the best person too. He is a very paramour for a sweet voice.
You must say paragon. A paramour is, God bless us, a thing of naught.
Masters, the Duke is calling from the temple, and there's two or three lords and ladies more married. If our score had gone forward, we had all been made men.
Where are these lads? Where are these hearts?
Bottom, O most courageous day, O most happy hour.
Masters, I entered this course wonders.
Let us hear, sweet Bottom.
Not a word of me. All that I will tell you is that the Duke hath dined. Get your apparel together, meet presently at the palace, every man look o'er his part. Dear actors, eat no onions nor garlic, for we are to utter sweet breath. And I do not hear, and I do not doubt, but to hear them say, it is a sweet comedy. No more words, away. Go away.
"'Tis strange, my Theseus, that these lovers speak of."
"'More strange than true. I never may believe these antique fables nor these fairy toys."
"'But all the stories of the night told over, and all their minds transfigured together, "'more witnesseth than fancy's image, and grow something of great constancy."
"'Here come the lovers full of joy and mirth!" "'Joy, gentle friends! Joy in fresh days of love! Accompany your hearts!"
"'Morgan to us, waiting your roller walks, your border, your bed!"
"'Come now, what masks, what dances shall we have? to wear away this long age of 3 hours between our after supper and bedtime. Where is our usual manager of mirth? Call Philostrate.
Here, mighty Theseus.
Say, what abridgment have you for this evening? What mask, what music? How shall we beguile the lazy time, if not with some delight?
Here's a brief, how many sports are ripe. Make choice of which your highness will see first.
Battle with the Centaurs, to be sung by an Athenian eunuch to the harp. Well, none of that. The riot of the Tisbe Bacchanals, tearing the Thracian singer in their rage. That is an old device, and it was played when I from Thebes came last to conquer. A tedious brief scene of young Pyramus and his love Thisbe. Very tragical mirth. Merry and tragical? Tedious and brief? That is hot ice and wondrous strange snow. How shall we find the concord of this discord?
A play there is, my lord, some 10 words long, which is as brief as I have known a play. But by 10 words, my lord, it is too long, which makes it tedious, for in all the play there is not one word apt, one player fitted. And tragical, my noble lord, it is, for Pyramus therein doth kill himself, which when I saw rehearsed, I must confess, made mine eyes water. But more merry tears the passion of loud laughter never shed.
What are they that do play it?
Hard-handed men that work in Athens here, which never labored in their minds till now.
And we will hear it.
No, my noble lord, it is not for you. I have heard it over, and it is nothing, nothing in the world.
I will hear that play, for never anything can be amiss, when simpleness and duty tender it. Go, bring them in, and take your place, ladies.
I love not to see wretchedness o'er charged and duty in his service perishing.
Why, gentle sweet, you shall see no such thing.
He says they could do nothing of this kind.
The kind are we, to give them thanks for nothing.
So please, your grace, the prologue is addressed.
Let him approach.
If we offend, is with our goodwill that you should think we come not to offend, but with goodwill to show our simple skill, that is the true beginning of our end. Consider then we come into despite. We do not come as minded to contest you. Our true intent is all for your delight. We are not here that you should repent you. The actors are at hand, and by their show you shall know all that you are like to know.
This fellow doth not stand upon points.
Indeed, he hath played on his prologue like a child on a recorder, a sound but not in government.
Who's next?
Gentles, pretend you wonder at the show, but wonder until truth makes all things plain. This man, Pyramus, if you would know, this beauteous lady Thisbe is certain. This man with lime and rough cast doth present wall, that vile wall, which did these lovers sunder, and through walls chink poor souls they are content to whisper, at the which let no man wonder, this man with lantern dog and bush of thorn presenteth moonshine, for, if you will know, by moonshine did these lovers think no scorn. To meet Nina's tomb, there to woo, this grisly beast which lion hight by name, this trusty Thisbe coming first by night, did scare away, or rather did a flight. But as she fled, her mantle did she fall, which lion vile with bloody mouth did stain. Anon comes Pyramus, sweet youth and tall, and finds his trusty Thisbe mantle slain. Whereat, with bloody blameful blade, he bravely broached his boiling bloody breast, and Thisbe, tearing in mulberry shade, his dagger drew and died. For all the rest, let lion, moonshine, wall, and the lovers twain at large discourse, while here they do remain.
I wonder if the lion be to speak.
No wonder, my lord, one lion may, when many asses do.
In this same interlude, it doth befall that I, when snout by name, present a wall, and such a wall as I would have you think, that had in it a crannied hole or chink, through which the lovers Pyramus and Thisbe did whisper often very secretly, and this the cranny is right and sinister, through which the fearful lovers are to whisper.
Would you desire lime and hair to speak better?
It is the readiest partition that ever I hear discourse, my lord.
O grim looks night, O night with hue so black, O night which ever art when day is not, O night, alack, 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 I fear my Thisbe's promise is forgot, and thou, O wall, O sweet and lovely wall that standeth between her father's ground and mine. Thou wall, O sweet and lovely wall. Show me thy chink to blink through with mine eye. Thanks, courteous wall, Jove shield thee well for this. But what I see, no Thisbe do I see, O wicked wall, through though whom I see no bliss. Cursed be thy stones for thus deceiving me.
The wall, methinks, being sensible, should curse again.
No, in truth, sir, he should not. Deceiving me is Thisbe's cue. She is to enter now, and I am to spy her through the wall. You shall see, it shall fall pat as I told you. Yonder she comes.
O wall, full often hast thou heard my moans, for parting my hair, Pyramus, and me. My cherry lips have often kissed thy stones with wine and hair knit up in thee.
I see a voice. Now I will to the chink to spy, and I can hear my Thisbe's face. Thisbe!
My love, thou art my love, I think.
Think what thou wilt. I am thy lover's grace, and, like Lymander, am I trusty still.
And like Helen, till the fates me kill.
Oh, kiss me through the hole of this vile wall.
I kiss the wall's hole, not your lips at all.
Wilt thou at Ninny's tomb meet me straight away?
Tide life, tide death, I come without delay.
Thus have I, while my part discharged so, and being done, this flesh walled away doth go.
This is the silliest stuff that I ever heard.
The best in this kind are but shadows, and the worst are no worse, if imagination amend them.
It must be your imagination, then, and not theirs.
If we imagine no worse of them than they are of themselves, they may pass for excellent men. Here come two noble beasts in, a man and a lion.
You ladies, you, whose gentle hearts do fear, the smallest mysterious mouse that creeps on floor, may now perchance both beg and tremble here, when lion wrath in wildest doth roar. Then know that I snug join near him. For if I should as lion come in strife into this place, 'twere pity on my life.
A very gentle beast of a good conscience.
This lantern doth the horned moon present.
He should have worn the horns on his head.
This lantern doth the horned moon present. Myself the man and the moon do seem to be.
This is the greatest error of all the rest. The man should be put into the lantern. How is it else the man and the moon?
I'm aweary of this moon. Would he would change.
Proceed, moon.
All that I have to say is, to tell you that this lantern is the moon, I the man in the moon, this thorn bush my thorn bush, and this dog my dog.
This is old Ninny's tomb. Where is my love?
Rawr.
Well worn, lion.
Well run, Thisbe.
Well shown, moon. Truly, the moon shines with a good grace.
Well moused, lion.
Sweet moon, I thank thee for thy sunny beams. I thank thee, moon, for shining now so bright. For by thy gracious golden glittering gleams, I trust to take the truest Thisbe sight. But stay, O spite, but mark, poor knight, what dreadful dole is here. Eyes, do you see? How can it be? O dainty duck, that, O dear, thy mantle good, what, stained with blood? Approach, ye furries fell, O furries, come, cut thread and thrum, quail, crash, conclude and quell.
This passion and the death of a dear friend would go near to make a man look sad.
Beshrew my heart, but I pity the man.
Oh, wherefore, nature, didst thou lion's frame? Since lion vol hath her dear flowered, my dear, which was the fairest dame that lived, that loved, that liked, that looked with cheer. Come tears, confound, out sword, out wound. The pap of Pyramus, the left pap where the heart doth hop. Thus I die. Thus die I. Thus. Now I am dead. Now I am fled. My soul in the sky. Tongue, lose thy light. Moon, take my flight. Now die.
How chanced moonshine is gone before Thisbe comes back and finds her lover?
She will find him by starlight. Here she comes, and her passion ends the play.
Methinks she should not use the long one for such a pyramus. I hope she will be brief.
Oh, sweet my love, what dead my love? Oh, pyramus, arise, speak, quite dumb, dead, a tomb. Must cover thy sweet eyes, these my lips, this cherry nose, these yellow castle cheeks are gone. Lovers make moan, his eyes were green as leeks, tongue not a word. Come, trusty sword, come blade my breast and brew, and farewell, friends, thus Thisbe ends.
Oh.
Audio.
Moonshine and Lion are left to bury the dead.
Aye, and Wald too.
No, I assure you, the wall is down that parted their fathers. Will it please you to see the epilogue?
No epilogue, I pray you, for your play needs no excuse. Never excuse, for when the players are all dead, there needs none to be blamed. Let your epilogue alone. The iron tongue of midnight hath tolled 12. Lovers, to bed, 'tis almost fairy time. A fortnight hold we this solemnity, in nightly revels and new jollity.
While the hungry lion roars, and the wolf behowls the moon.
The heavy plowman snores, all weary tasks are done.
Now the wasted brands do blow, whilst the screech owl, screeching loud, puts the wretch that lies in woe in remembrance of a shroud.
Now it is the time of night that the graves all gaping wide. Everyone lets horses spray and church way past the cot.
And we fairies that do run by the triple Hecate's team from the presence of the sun, following darkness like a dream. Now our frolic.
Not a mouse shall disturb this hallowed house.
I am sent with broom before to sweep the dust behind the door.
Through the house give glimmering light by the dead and drowsy fire. Every elf and fairy sprite hop as light as bird from briar.
Hand in hand with fairy grace, we will sing and bless this place.
Now, until the break of day, through this house each fairy stray.
To the best bride bed we will, which by us shall blessed be.
And the issue there create ever shall be fortunate.
So shall all the couples three ever true in loving be.
Trip away. Make no stay. Meet me all by break of day.
If we shadows have offended, think but this and all is mended, that you have but slumbered here whilst these visions did appear.
In this week an idle theme, no more yielding but a dream.
Gentles, do not reprehend. If you pardon, we will mend.
And as I am an honest pup, if we have unearned luck, now to escape the serpent's tongue, we will make amends ere long.
Else the pup a liar call, so good night unto you all.
Give me your hands, if we be friends, and Robin shall restore amends.
Love was out to get me. That's the way it seems.
saw her face. I'm a believer and not a trace of doubt in my mind. I'm in love. I'm a believer. I couldn't leave her if I tried. I thought love was more or less a given thing. The more I gave, the less I got. Oh yeah. What's the use of trying? All you get is pain. When I wanted sunshine, I got rain. And then I saw her.
You draw me, you hard-hearted adamant, but yet you draw me not. I messed up.
How now, spirit? Whither wander you? I did it wrong again.
The king doth keep his revels here. Oh my god!
You like for rain?
The next thing, having once this juice, I'll watch Titania when she is asleep, and drop the liquor of it in her eyes. The next thing she then waking.
Snug to join. Are you the lion's part? I hope yours are play fitted.
Oh. I was muted.
To meet at Nina's tomb, there to woo this grisly beast, which lion hight by name, this trusty Thisbe, come first.
There's some pink on this.
That's it? We did it?
Perfect. Yes.
Finito.